Well, it's about time to get started here on our Sunday morning service. Good to have everybody. Just appreciate the effort that everybody has made to be here. It's a little bit cold, and they're talking about the weather, you know, maybe being a little unpredictable, but we're glad you're here to worship the Lord, and we're going to have a good time in the Lord today. We're going to have a good time with one another, and I think that's what we need to do is appreciate one another. And, you know, like I say sometimes, it's good to see the smile on your face when you walk in the door. So we're going to get started in our song service.
I wandered so aimless,
life
with sin.
I wouldn't let my
dear Savior in.
Then Jesus came
like a stranger in the night.
Praise the Lord,
I saw the light.
I saw the light,
I saw the light. Singing as I go, pointing south to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, through Him I must win. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. There's all plans, homeland, ever to rejoice. When in valleys low I look toward the mountain high, and behold my Savior there, leading in the fight. With a tender hand outstretched toward the valley low, guiding me, I can see as I onward go. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. For me pillows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs.
train on the streets of glory. Let me lift my voice, cares all past, home and land, ever to rejoice.
Would everybody clap their hands while we sing that chorus again? Don't you want to see him? And everybody.
Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice, cares all past, home and land, ever to rejoice. When in valleys low I look toward the mountain high, and behold my Savior there, leading in the fight, with a tender hand outstretched toward the valley low, guiding me, I can see as I onward go. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice, cares all past, home and land, ever to rejoice. As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me, leads me safely through the sinking sand. Is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, dear Lord, each day, help me do the best I can. I need thy light to guide me day and night, blessed Jesus, over my head. Jesus, over my head, I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. Will please, oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, oh my head. Let me travel in the light divine, that I might see the blessed way. Keep me that I may behold thine, sing redemption song someday. I will be a soldier, brave and true, ever firmly take a stand. As I onward go and daily meet the foe, blessed Jesus, oh my. Jesus, hold my hand, I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. Hear my feeble plea, oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. When I wander through the valley dim, toward the setting of the sun, lead me safely to a land of rest, by a crown of life have won. Put my faith in thee, dear Lord, I might reach the golden thread. There's no other friend on whom I can depend. Blessed Jesus, hold my head.
my head. I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. Hear my feeble plea, O Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. I need thee every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. Hear my feeble plea, oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. When I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Singing the third verse when Jerry's going to sing the second. But with Lotus, whenever she asked you guys to clap, that really looked good. And it sounded good. I mean, that was, you know, that was a good thing. So there you go. So, you know, you don't always have to wait for Lotus to ask you to clap, because that really added to everything. There you go. And appreciate David being here. That was a strange noise you heard back here. Just a banjo. And like someday Lisa is going to bring her mandolin. I don't know when. But we appreciate everybody here. Appreciate our visitors. Really, I don't know how many that are still visitors. But, you know, we do appreciate everyone that's been here today. Appreciate Bob being back. We've been missing him. And so, again, that's just an answer to prayer, and that's what we've been singing about. Barbara's doing great. That's an answer to everybody praying for her. And, you know, we all still got a lot of things that we can do, but we just appreciate everyone holding everyone else up in prayer. And so I think that kind of goes along with our song service. And we'll get turned over to Wayne here in a minute. So we're taking up our tithes and offering at this time.
You know, a lot of these songs you do take off the same way. And boy, I can't remember how it even starts off. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass, whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Seem like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love, you're slow to anger, your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my.
my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years, then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name.
Appreciate these.
How many of you know this chorus? How many of you know the chorus? Would you all sing? I told Jerry on the way over here, and he told me not to do it, so I'm disobeying my husband. There's so much power in blessing the Lord, and as a congregation, if you all would help us sing this chorus.
You're rich in love, you're slow to anger, your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all Your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name.
Amen. I think Lori and Heather are coming at this time. Appreciate these two gals. Appreciate their willingness. Not only their willingness, but everyone else's willingness that is here. And so we just, you know, thinking about, it seemed like all these songs to me has kind of been about prayer. You know, if we look around, we see somebody that's here because of prayer, Bob, you know. And so we just, we appreciate everyone.
Thank you.
Her when she's not here, she's a big part. And Larry and David filled in good, but we do miss her, and we just, you know, we miss you when you're not here. So we're going to turn the service to Brother Wayne.
You know, when I got saved, I was taught to obey them that have rule over you in the Lord. And there's scripture that backs that up. Well, Sister Lotus asked us to clap our hands. She was leading, so I believe in obeying them that have rule over me in the Lord. I start to clap my hands. I didn't get three claps in, and I was told to stop. I mean, me not being able to keep time should have nothing to do with that, right? And it wasn't Lotus telling me that, but y'all figured that out. Praise the Lord. Isn't God good? Amen. So good to come to God's house and to just fellowship with his people and to worship the Lord together. I'm amazed at how the Lord orchestrates a service. The girl's just saying, all I need is Jesus. And here in a few moments, I'm going to sing a song that I've never sang before. That says, I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. And then the message that I'm going to bring forth is Jesus now more than ever. It all goes together, doesn't it? Amen. God is so good. It is good having those that's been sick back with us. Good having visitors with us. Good having the folks from Wisconsin with us. They were a visitor last week. This week they're just home folk. Amen. The Ozarks is a wonderful place to live, just saying. But amen. All right, we're going to try doing this song. I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. About this load I carry, and don't be concerned if it sends me to my knees. For I know a place where all my load will lighten, and I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. If my feeble hands of faith could only reach out through the dark and dreary storm of unbelief, if he'll slip his nail-scarred hand into my hand, I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. Very soon now, I'll reach the hill of Golgotha. I'll touch the cross that was fashioned from a tree. And if one drop of his blood, if it touches me, I'll be all right, because now I've reached Calvary. If my feeble hands of faith
could only reach out through the dark and dreary storm of unbelief. If he'll slip his nail-scarred hand into my hand, I'll be all right as soon as I touch Calvary. Yeah, I'm all right because I touch Calvary. Praise the Lord. Do you remember the day that you touched Calvary? Amen. I'll never forget that day. I'll never forget it. Never. There was something that took place at an altar of prayer that I can't describe. Never forget it. Everything that I carried to the altar that day was made right when I touched Calvary. I don't know about you, but I'll never forget the burdens being lifted away. I'll never forget the transformation that I felt taking place in my life. I'll never forget the things that was holding me down and destroying my life and destroying my relationships. How that it was all healed at an altar of prayer, August the 30th of 1982, at 11:45 at night. I love that song because that song speaks to me. How I was all right when I touched Calvary. I wasn't all right before I got to that altar. I wasn't all right when I was walking up that aisle. But when I knelt, and when I said, Lord, I know I'm not much. And Lord, I don't really know how to pray. But Lord, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. If you'll forgive me of my sins, and if you'll give me a fresh start, I promise you I'll do the best I can for the rest of my life. Has there been problems along the way? Has there been setbacks? Yeah, there has. But it's then where he says, I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you. I'm not talking about unconditional eternal security. I'm talking about eternal security when you just keep on keeping on and you just keep doing the best you can. By the lifting of hands, is there any Christian in here that since you've been saved that you've ever been knocked down? You know why you're here today? Because you got up. Did you know it's hard to defeat somebody that just will not stay down? Amen. Well, that's not my message, but it could be. Turn your Bibles to John chapter 6. I want to start reading at verse 63. I want to read 63, and then I want to jump over to verse 66. In John chapter 6 and verse 63, Jesus made this statement. It is the Spirit that quickeneth. In other words, it is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Now verse 66. From that time, notice what Jesus had just said. He said, it is the Spirit that makes alive, and the flesh profiteth nothing. And he went on to tell them, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life.
And in verse 66, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will you also go away? Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure. I like that. Believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. This morning, for just a few moments, I want to talk about how that we need Jesus now more than ever. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We thank you for your word. We thank you for this church. We thank you for your presence that we have felt in here today. Now, as we come to the preaching of the word, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Draw us close to you and close to one another. For Lord, we need you now more than ever. In Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen. Whether they realize it or not, the world is crying out for more of Jesus. That old song that says, Jesus now more than ever. We are sailing in stormy weather. All God's children should get together, for we need Jesus now more than ever. I want to tell you that in these troublesome times, it calls for more of Jesus. We need Jesus now more than ever for the day in which we are living. We don't need another program, a gimmick, or gadget. We don't need another ideology or even another religion. We just need Jesus now more than ever. In these days of confusion and crime and catastrophe, we need Jesus more than ever. In the days of restlessness and hopelessness, nuclear, computer, and political power, we need Jesus now more than ever. In the world in which we live, where there's wars and rumors of wars and destruction, and there is distress among nations, we need Jesus now more than ever. As we look into our own country and we see all the ungodliness and the violence and the injustice and the rioting and the pillaging and the burning down of businesses in our major cities and how the crime rate has gone crazy, we need Jesus now more than ever. You and I, the world, and the church needs Jesus now more than ever. Turn to somebody and say, we need Jesus now. First of all, we need Jesus now more than ever in our own individual life. Listen, we can't give it away if we don't got it. Some people advertise in the window what they don't have on the shelf. Church, if we're going to advertise it in the window, we better have it when they come in. 1 Corinthians 9:14, they which preach the gospel should live the gospel. Jesus wants to have a personal relationship with us. The word relationship comes from the word relative, which means related, kindred, connected by blood. Jesus wants to have a kindred, related, connected by blood relationship with us. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and I'll heal their land. Proverbs 8:17 says, I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. Hebrews 11:6 says that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Other words, he is a rewarder of them that will go after him. Relationship with God comes when we pray and seek his face. God is looking for somebody who will just go after him. God's looking for somebody that won't look to the left nor to the right, but they'll fix their eyes on Jesus, and they'll continue to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of their faith. You see, relationship with God comes when we live according to the Word of God. Amen. Jesus in John 15:7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Amen. Why are there people in here today that's been very sick, but we've been praying for them, and they're here today? Because if we abide in him and he abides in us, we shall ask what we will, and it shall be done unto him. Amen. It shall be done. Amen. Why is Sister Barbara getting better every day, who has been through hell on earth with the surgeries and everything that she's going through, but every day she's getting stronger? Why is that? Because Jesus said, if you abide in me and I abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done. Relationship. Knowing God. The Apostle Paul said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Relationship with God comes when we desire his presence more than anything. In John 4:24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Listen, worship is a means of nourishing my spirit. When this praise team and band is up here singing the songs of Zion and I'm worshiping God, what am I doing? I'm just nourishing my spirit. I'm feeding my spirit on those things that will help me grow spiritually. Worship is a means of achieving spiritual growth and spiritual development. There are too many anemic Christians that have been saved for years, and the reason they're staying anemic is they're not in the Word and they're not in the worship. But if you get into worship and you get in the Word, your spiritual man will receive the nourishment that it needs, and you will spiritually grow and spiritually develop. Worship is a means of expressing my love to God. Worship is an avenue that God has provided by which I can praise him. Amen. Worship is the offering of spiritual sacrifices. He will accept those sacrifices of praise. What is a sacrifice of praise? It's just praising God when you feel like it, and it's praising God when you don't feel like it. It's praising God as a lifestyle. Listen, if the only time that we praise God is when we come to the house of God, we are missing out, my friend, because the same presence of God that you feel here, you can feel out there. You can feel in your home. You can feel on your job. You can feel it as you're driving down the road. Just get yourself in a place of praise and worship. And the Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people. Worship is not a song, a style, a position, or a hype. Worship is going after God with all of your heart. Amen. Now, some of these other things may be used as a vehicle to accelerate someone into the presence of God. But when you break it all down, worship is nothing more or less than you going after God. Number two, not only do we need Jesus more in our individual life, but we need Jesus now more than ever in our home. The majority of modern-day families are in spiritual trouble. Parents must realize that they have a major responsibility concerning their children. And if the parents won't do it, grandparents, step up and step in. And you do it. It takes more than putting clothes on their back and food in their stomach and a roof over their head. Any public institution can do that. Amen. What they need is spiritual guidance and love. What they need is to see an example of somebody that is sold out, that loves God with all of their heart, their soul, their mind, and their strength. Amen. If God is not welcome in the home, then that home is destined to collapse. Before we can expect young people to grow in Christ, church, we have to be growing in Christ. Ron Mobley made this statement. He said, since parents are the role models for children, don't be surprised when you see spiritual dropouts among our youth. Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Parents must make wise decisions concerning the spiritual destination of their family. For Jesus said, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and lose his own soul? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Galatians 6:7, be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Listen, I still believe that the family that prays together stays together. I still believe that the family that lifts up Jesus together is lifted up by Jesus. I still believe that the family that loves God will love one another. The family that worships together will spend eternity together worshiping God. So what am I saying? I'm saying that whether we're here in this building or if we're watching by live stream, I'm saying there comes a time to turn off the TV, put down the newspaper, turn on to God's word, and find out what thus saith the Lord God. Amen. Joshua 24:15, Moses was dead. The Israelites were without a great leader. They didn't know what to do. Joshua stands to the forefront, and he said, choose you this day whom you're going to serve, but as for me and my house, we are going to serve God. Amen. Have you made up your mind you're going to serve God? Jesus now, more than ever. But not only do we need Jesus now more than ever in our individual life and in our home, but friend, we need Jesus now more than ever in our church. Amen. Jesus must be the head of the church. Pastors aren't the head of the church. As a matter of fact, if pastors ever become the head of the church, they need to fire that guy and get somebody else in that'll give God all the glory. Amen. Jesus must be the head of the church. Without Jesus as the head, the church is dead. Anything with two heads, they call it a freak and belongs in a circus or a sideshow. Jesus said this. He said, I will build my church. Somebody say my church. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. It's God's church. I know preachers who won't take a family vacation because they're afraid that the church won't survive if they're gone. If that church is just built on their personality and their gifts and their talents and their calling and their anointing, then that is a church that is destined to fall anyway. Listen, I don't stand up here and preach the Word of God and study all week and do what I do to try to get you to follow me. Amen. Because if you follow me far enough and long enough, you're going to find out that there's some things that you'll be, well, I just don't know. That's not my style. That's not my personality. Amen. I'm not after to get you to follow me. But if I can get you to follow him, and if I can follow him, and if we can come together as a church like a mighty army and follow him, I tell you, it's when we follow him together that God will open the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that there won't be enough room to contain. It's then that the glow and the glory and the presence and the anointing of God will fill this house. It is then that the Shekinah glory will hover over here and the presence of the Lord will take over. If we follow him, come on, give him praise. If you made up your mind you're going to follow him, just give him praise. Hallelujah. With my children growing up, I've never been afraid to take a family vacation. Because I said a long time ago, if I lose them, I have nothing to say to the world. And I've had preacher friends who said, well, now, Wayne, I know you mean well, but you shouldn't make that statement. And I'm like, I wouldn't have made it if I didn't believe it. Hey, man, you know, I believe that if my wife and I go on vacation, and we're going to do that, just don't know when yet, but if we went on vacation, I don't think this church would fail. I don't think it would fall. As a matter of fact, it was here way before we got here, and it'll be here way after we're out of here. Amen. Why is that? Because it is God's church. Jesus said, I will build my church. He didn't say that we'll build our church. He didn't say that I'll build your church. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. You see, church is not a social event. Church is a spiritual encounter. Church is not a place to meet potential business prospects. It is a place to come together and meet God. Church is not a place to feel religious. Amen. The world don't need to feel religious. Religion will kill a dead man in a graveyard at midnight. The church needs to feel Jesus. Church is a place to feel the presence of God. God help us if we come to this house and we go through religious rituals and routines and formalities and we leave God's house and never felt him in the service. But that doesn't happen because we come together in one mind and one accord and come together in unity. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. If you felt God's presence in here today and you felt him last week and you're expecting to feel him next week, give the Lord praise in this house. Thank you, Jesus. Church is not a place to see and be seen. It's not about a fad or a fashion. It's a place to see and experience the glory of God. Church is a place to worship God. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. In that passage of scripture, he's talking about if I be lifted up on a cross, if I give it all, if I die, if I'm crucified, I will draw all men unto me. But I think we can also say that in worship. We can say that in worship and not take it out of context. If we lift Jesus up, he will draw all men unto him. Ephesians 5 and 27, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Listen, many churches today have become nothing more than a referral committee. The reason many churches have become referral committees is because they can no longer get the job done. They have no presence, no power, and no purpose. Oh, they have all the noise. They have the shout. They have the hype. They have the performance. They have the production down to a T. Just no power. They refer the alcoholic to Alcoholic Anonymous. They refer the drug addict to drug rehabilitation. They refer the mentally disturbed to the asylum. They refer the emotionally hurting to the psychiatrist. And listen, I'm not saying all of these programs are bad because they have done some good. But what really needs to happen is that the church says, before you go to these programs, come to the house of God. Alcoholic, you want to get delivered, come to the house of God. Drug addict, you want to get delivered, come to the house of God. Well, how do you know that God will deliver me? Because he delivered my pastor, and he delivered others, and he'll deliver you. Amen. And he is no respecter of persons. He loves us all the same.
I'm just old-fashioned enough to believe that Jesus is still the answer. Amen. In 2 Timothy 3 and 5, it talks about that the last day church would have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof, from such turn away. Jesus is still the answer. He always has been, he is now, and he always will be. Amen. His time hasn't ran out. He hasn't ran his course. His power hasn't diminished. His love hasn't been depleted. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And in Malachi, he says, "For I am the Lord, I change not." As a matter of fact, in John 14 and 6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me." In other words, he said, you could sign all of the membership cards you want to sign, and that don't make you saved. You can go around shaking preachers' hands, and that won't make you saved. Be better off to shake a donkey's tail. You get more of a kick out of it. You can go through all the religious rituals and rules and regulations. You can follow all of the man-made rules that has been set up. You can go through all of that to try to make yourself look like a Christian, but Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me." The way of salvation is through Jesus. The way of healing is through Jesus. The way of purpose in your life is through Jesus. The way of peace in your life is through Jesus. The way of unity in your marriage and in your family and in your home is through Jesus. Amen. The way to get to God is through Jesus. If you believe that, give him praise. Hallelujah. There must be a move of God in the church. Without a genuine move of God, Pentecostalism will die. Without a genuine move of the Spirit of God, our families, our friends, and our neighbors will die. How many knows there is a difference in fishing and wishing? There's a difference of sitting on the bank or out in the boat wishing you'd catch fish than what there is actually catching fish. Amen. How many loves to fish? How many just love just going and catching nothing? Amen. I would rather catch fish than just go fishing. Amen. Just sitting there wishing I was fishing doesn't put wall mounters on my wall. Ain't got a whole lot of them up there anyway, but I enjoy the ones I got. Well, some are wishing for the church to somehow just grow. Others are preparing themselves to be instruments of God in church growth as fishers of men. Matter of fact, in Mark 1 and 17, Jesus said, "Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men." The only hope for a sin-infested world is a spirit-filled church, is a spirit-filled preacher, a spirit-filled teacher, a spirit-filled musician, a spirit-filled worship leader, a spirit-filled worshiper. Amen. That's the only hope for a sin-infested world. Jesus now more than ever. I close by asking you this, whether you're here or whether you're watching by social media today. Where does Jesus stand in your life? I want to ask another question. You know, I'm just going to get a little nosy today. Is your spiritual life red hot or ice cold? Are you walking in the Spirit and enjoying the presence of God? John 6, verse 66, from that time,
Many of the disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, Will you also go away? And Simon Peter, I like Simon Peter. Simon Peter had his problems. Someone once said Simon Peter was hot-tempered, big mouth, and besides all of that, he smelled fishy. Simon Peter was the one that said, Lord, these others may deny you, but I won't. Jesus said, you'll deny me three times before the cock crows. And he did. But Simon Peter wept bitterly. He repented. Simon Peter said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Would you stand with me? We need Jesus now more than ever. We need him in our individual life. We need him in our home. And we need him in our church. And he is in our church. But we need to keep him here. Here's an old song. You probably know it. Just sing it along with us. Jesus now, more than ever, we are sailing in stormy weather. All God's children should get together. This third verse talks about the day in which we're living in the book of
as a country
in that direction. Only Jesus' blood can give protection. Jesus now, more than ever, we are sailing in stormy weather. All God's children should get together, for we need Jesus now more than ever.
Keep playing.
Amen. Brother Doug's been having some problems with his leg. Would you stretch your hands this way and let's pray for him. Father, in the name. Amen. Anybody else need special prayer this morning? Amen. Pray for Missy. She was getting ready to come to church, but her husband is not doing very well. And so remember Missy and her husband. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bring Missy before you, God. We bring her husband before you. We pray healing for his body and strength for Sister Missy. We stand on your word. We claim your promises. Amen. Lord, for Sister Bonnie, Lord, who is scheduled to go see the doctor tomorrow, she has to make a very serious decision. I pray, God, that you would give her direction. Lord, you're able to heal her before she ever gets there. We stand on your word. Claim your promises in Jesus' name. Amen. Anybody else need special prayer? Pray for Sister Lily. Call her name out to God. Father, for Sister Lily, we pray healing for her, Lord. We rebuke this COVID that has gripped her body. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray complete healing for her. And continue to heal this shoulder. Oh, God, let her know that her church family, even though she's not here today, hasn't forgotten about her. In Jesus' name, Lord, continue to strengthen and heal Barbara. I'm looking forward to the day that she's back in the house of God. Hallelujah. Anybody else have a prayer request? Amen. Praise the Lord. Pray over the prayer box. Father, in the name of Jesus, every request that is in this prayer box, I pray that you would meet the need, Lord. Whether it be salvation, healing, financial blessing, emotional healing, whatever it is, God, we put it in your hands in Jesus' name. Amen. He wants to become a member of this church. Rededicate. Well, read. Well, do you love the Lord? Do you believe that he died upon a cross, was buried, came out of the grave triumphant over death, hell, and the grave? Do you believe that he's sitting at the right hand of the Father making intercession for you right now? Well, repeat these words after me. Lord Jesus, re-enter my heart and my mind and my life. Lord, in many ways, I've strayed. But God, you left the 99 to search out for that one. And that one today is me. So I ask for your forgiveness, your help, your strength. And from this moment on, I will do my best to walk in your ways,
to do your will, to walk in light of the scripture as it shines upon my path. And I give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Why do we take it in religion, try to make it so complex, the simplicity of the gospel? Amen. You love the Lord today? Do you believe that we need Jesus now more than ever? Give the Lord praise. Shake hands, hug next. We love you guys.